الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإذ غدوت من أهلك تبوئ المؤمنين مقاعد للقتال والله سميع عليم إذ همت طائفتان منكم أن تفشلا والله وليهما وعلى الله فليتوكل المؤمنون ولقد نصركم الله ببدر وأنتم أذلة فاتقوا الله لعلكم تشكرون صدق الله العظيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم ربنا ألهمنا رشدنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى آمين يا رب العالمين From the 13th section of Surah Aalay-Imran Now a very long discourse It contains commentary from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the events of the Battle of Uhud This battle was fought in the month of Shawwal, in the third year after Hijrah. And when that was actually, according to the Arabic tradition, that because at Badr, the Quraysh of Makkah had a very bad defeat, now they had to take the revenge. So they made full preparations, an army 3,000 strong, a very big army by the standards of those days. Well armed, well provided. It reached the vicinity of Medina. Then there was a consultation held by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His own opinion was that we should defend Medina while remaining in the city and not go out. The same was the opinion of the chief of the Munafiqeen, Abdullah ibn Ubay. Incidentally, he also held the same opinion. But the Prophet saw, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that many youth, especially the young people, especially those who had either entered Islam after the Battle of Badr, although they were Muslims already before Badr, but they couldn't go to Badr. They were very anxious to go and have a direct combat, man-to-man, face-to-face fight. And they said, we need the shahada, martyrdom. So why should we go in the open field and confront the enemies of Allah? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he cared for the sentiments that they had and decided finally, okay, we shall go out and fight the enemy in the open field. Then he set forth from Medina with 1,000 men. But after he reached the battlefield, Abdullah ibn Ubay with 300 of his companions, he deserted. He went back to Medina. He said, when our opinions are not respected, why should we risk our lives? So now it was a big setback, a big shock. Already they were one-third in number. 1,000 were to face 3,000. Now the ratio proportion was reduced to one-fourth. Now there were only 700 who had to face 3,000 strong army. Well provided, well armed. Anyhow, when the fighting began, Muslims were victorious. And very soon, the army of the Quraysh from Mecca, they were on their heels, they were running off. But at that time, there was a mistake committed by 35 persons of Muslims. The Prophet had posted 50 men. There was a pass behind the position of the Muslims. And there could be that the enemy cavalry could charge through that pass. So Prophet posted, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 50 archers at that place to keep the enemy at bay. But when they saw, those 50 people, that the battle has been decided and Muslims have got the victory, the enemy forces are running, so they left the place. Although the commander who was posted there, he said to them till the last moment, don't leave this place. Remember the instructions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you will never in any case leave this place. You will remain here. But out of 50, 35, They disobeyed him, they left the place. Khalid ibn Walid was leading the cavalry, 100-horse cavalry they had. He saw that moment, and he encircled the mountain, and from that pass he charged. And that actually was a very bad moment for the Muslims. The victory changed into defeat. 70 of the Sahaba were martyred. The Prophet himself was wounded. So this was a big shock to the Muslims. 1 year after Badr, Badr was a source of big support. The morale of the Muslims had gone high after Badr. They had defeated Quraysh, 3 times their number. So the whole of Arabian Peninsula, the Muslims got a very high name. But now the wind was gone. The conditions were changed. Now this 60 ayat long, there is a discourse from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are comments. What are the weaknesses, O Muslims? You should see the weaknesses in your ranks. You must mend your ways because the struggle is still going on. You'll have to face harder positions, harder situations. So whatever weaknesses have come to the surface, you must try to remedy them. This is the basic subject of the coming 60 ayat. I can't say how many of them we shall be able to read today. وَإِذْ غَدَوْتَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ. And just recall, O Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when you left your family in the early morning, تُبَوِّئُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ مَقَاعِدَ لِلْقَتَالِ, you were assigning the Muslims their stations and positions, you are posting them for the battle. وَاللَّهُ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. And Allah is all-hearing, all-knowing. إِذْ هَمَّتْ طَائِفَتَانِ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ تَفْشَلَا. It's very noteworthy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't even mention the munafiqeen here. The bigger event was that 300 deserted. But that incident has not been discussed here. As if they are not worth mentioning. Instead, among the Muslims, the remaining 700, two small groups were there who showed some weakness. They have been mentioned here. Is hammat ta'ifatani minkum an tafshala. When two parties of you were about to lose heart, they were Banu Harsa and Banu Salma, two families. They saw the difference in number, and for some time, for temporarily, there was weakness in their wills. Is hammat ta'ifatani minkum an tafshala. Wallahu waliyuhuma. Although Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was their protector, supporter, helper, they shouldn't have felt weak when Allah was on their side. وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. And people who really believe, they should have all their trust in Allah. Not in the numbers, not in the arms. All their trust should be in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyhow, it was a temporary phase. They then made up their mind, they stood. They remained there, they fought with the Muslims, and they were very proud later on that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned us in Quran. And He has referred to us as Izhammat Taifatane Minkum. They are from amongst you, O Muslims. They are not the hypocrites, they are not the munafiqeen. They are two groups from among yourself. So they were very proud that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has used these words about us. Izhammat Taifatane Minkum Antafshala. وَاللَّهُ وَلِيُّهُمَا وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had helped you in Badr. It was only 1 year before. وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّةٌ. And you were very weak. Very weak. Because at Badr Muslims didn't have even arms. I think only 7 had swords with them. Only 7 of them. Because actually when they started from Medina, they never knew that they had to fight an army. They thought that we have to go after the caravan. وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّةٌ. And Allah had helped you at Badr, although you were very weak. فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. So you should have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that you can be really grateful to Him. اِسْتَقُولُ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. When you were saying to the mu'mins, to the believers, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَلَنْ يَكْفِيَكُمْ وَيُمِدَّكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ بِسَلَاسَةِ عَلَافِ مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ مُنزَلِينَ. Is it not sufficient for you that your Lord helps you with 3,000 angels who will be sent down? So that was a good tiding for the Muslims that the Prophet gave. That don't fear, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send. If you have to confront 3,000 people of the enemy, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you with 3,000 angels. Bala, why not? Because this glad tidings was given by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ratifying it. Why not? In tasbiru wa tattaqu, our Prophet had said 3,000. Instead, if you show patience and perseverance, and if you, O Muslims, have the real taqwa, وَيَعْتُوكُمْ مِنْ فَوْرِهِمْ هَذَا, if your enemy attacks you straight off, this very moment, يُمْدِدْكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ بِخَمْسَةِ عَلَافٍ مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ مُسَوِّمِينَ, your Lord will help you with 5,000 angels who will come with their own standards, with their own marks. وَمَا جَعَلَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَّا مُشْتَعَلَكُمْ, and Allah made it only a good tidy, good news for you. وَلَتَطْمَئِنَّ بِهِ قُلُوبُكُمْ, so that your hearts are reassured with this. وَمَنْ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ, and there can be no help except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah doesn't need to send 5,000 angels also. Allah can help without any angel, without sending any angel. He can act only by saying be, and it becomes. But for reassurance to you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to send 5,000 angels. وَمَنْ نَصْرُ إِلَّا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَكِيمِ, there can be no help except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is all-powerful, who is all-wise. لَيَقْطَعَ طَرَفًا مِنَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, and Allah wanted to cut off a part and portion of the non-believers, أَوْ يَكْبِتَهُمْ, or to put them to humiliation. فَيَنْقَلِبُوا خَائِبِينَ, so that they had to return back frustrated. لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is not for you to decide. Actually what happened, when the Prophet himself was wounded, and blood gushed out of his cheek, and two of his teeth were martyred, and when much of bleeding had happened, and he felt weak, and there was unconsciousness for some time, then a few words came out of his mouth. كَيْفَ يَهْدِ اللَّهُ قَوْمًا خَصَبُوا وَجْهَ نَبِيِّهِمْ بِالدَّمْ, how will Allah guide a people who colored the face of their Prophet with blood? Because the whole face of the Prophet was red with blood, because the wound was here on the cheek. The cheekbone that was broken, and then from there the blood was gushing and the teeth were broken also. So when he said, كَيْفَ يَهْدِ اللَّهُ قَوْمًا خَصَبُوا وَجْهَ نَبِيِّهِمْ بِالدَّمْ, how can Allah guide the people who have colored and painted the face of their Prophet and Messenger of Allah with blood? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it's none of your business. It's up to us. We shall decide whether to punish them or to guide them or to accept their tawbah. This is our exclusive, our domain. It's not your domain. لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٌ, you don't have any authority in your hand. Mind you, O Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how yatuba alayhim, it is up to Allah. He may relent on them, he may accept their tawbah, or yu'azzibahum, or he may punish them. فَإِنَّهُمْ ظَالِمُونَ, there is no doubt, they are unjust, they have committed aggression against the Prophet. They deserve punishment, but maybe they repent, and then Allah may relent on us. So it is not for you to decide, it is for us to decide. Please note what happened. The same Khalid ibn Walid, who was the main reason of all what happened there, he was given the title of Sword of Allah. Khalidun Saifun min Suyufillah. Khalid is a sword from the swords of Allah. And that title was given by Muhammad himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because he later on, he accepted Islam. لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ أَوْ يَتُوبَ عَلَيْهِمْ أَوْ يُعَذِّبَهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ ظَالِمُونَ وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ, and to Allah belongs whatever is in the skies and heaven and whatever is on earth. يَغْفِرُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ, the same ayah that came in the end of the Surah Al-Baqarah. He forgives to whom he likes, and he punishes whosoever he likes. وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ, and Allah is essentially ghafoor. He is forgiving and he is merciful. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَعْكُلُوا الْرِبَى, O you who profess to believe, don't eat, don't devour usury. Azafat mudafa, doubled and redoubled. Wattaqullah, and have fear of Allah. Fear Allah's punishment. La'allakum tuflihoon, so that you can prosper. Now because this ayah was revealed in the third year, this is the preliminary injunction about riba. The ayat which we have studied in Surah Al-Baqarah, they were revealed in the ninth year after Hijrah. That is the final commandment about riba. So this is the preliminary, first commandment about riba here. وَتَقُلْ نَارَ الَّتِي عُعِدَّتْ لِلْكَافِرِينَ Now just see, in this surah, in Surah Al-Imran, there are 31 ayat which were revealed in the ninth year after Hijrah, when the deputation of the Christians of Najran came, and they are included in this surah, most of which was revealed in the third year. The ayat regarding the final prohibition of riba were revealed in the ninth year after Hijrah, and they are included in Surah Al-Baqarah, which was revealed in the second year after Hijrah. So the resemblances, similarities between these surah, they are coming up and they are adding up. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ Have Allah's taqwa, regard Him as you should regard Him, so that you can have falah, you can prosper. وَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ الَّتِي عُدَّتْ لِلْكَافِرِينَ And have fear of the fire which has been prepared for the unbelievers. وَاتِّعُوا اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ And obey Allah and His Messenger, so that mercy is given to you, mercy is shown to you. وَسَارِعُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ And compete with each other, why with each other? To get the forgiveness from your Lord, وَجَنَّةٍ And to get and reach the paradise, أَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ Whose breadth is just like the breadth of the heavens and the earth. أُعِدَّتْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ And that has been prepared for those having taqwa. الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ Who are those who have taqwa? الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ Who keep on expending and spending their money for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in prosperity as well as adversity. وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظَ Who can restrain their anger. وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ Who are forgiving for humanity towards people. وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ And Allah loves such good doers. وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً And those who, when they commit something which is indecent, by mistake, by error, something is committed by them which is indecent, أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ Or they do wrong to themselves in any other way. ذَكَرُوا اللَّهِ Instantly, immediately they remember Allah. Allah comes to their mind. فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ Then they repent what we have done. And they ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for their sins. وَمَنْ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ And who can forgive the sins except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. وَلَمْ يُسِرُّوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلُوا وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ And they don't insist and persist in this sin. Mistake is committed. The Prophet has been reported to have said in one hadith, كُلُّ بَنِي آدَمَ خَطَّاؤُونَ وَخَيْرُ الْخَطَّائِنَ التَّوَّابُونَ All mankind are those who commit errors. خَطَّاؤُونَ They go on committing errors. But among these خَطَّاؤُونَ Those who commit error, among them the best are those who repent, who revert to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who repent on what they have done, that they will not again commit this act and this sin. فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ وَيَغْفُرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَلَمْ يُسِرُّوا عَلَىٰ مَا فَعَلُوا وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ Knowingly, they do not insist and persist in that sin. أُولَٰئِكَ جَزَاؤُهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَجَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِن تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ They are the people for whom is the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from their Lord وَجَنَّاتٌ And for them are the gardens تَجْرِي مِن تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ Beneath which the rivers are flowing. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا They will dwell in them forever. وَنِعْمَ أَجْرُ الْعَامِلِينَ And how good is the reward for those people who do good works. قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ سُنَنٌ فَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ So many examples have passed before you. قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ سُنَنٌ You are not the first nation, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not the first messenger. So many messengers were sent before, so many nations. You know what happened to the people of Hud and people of Saleh? They were in this very Arabian Peninsula, these both nations. So قَدْ خَلَقْ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ سُنَنٌ فَسِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. You should travel in the land. فَانْظُرُوا كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الْمُكَذِّبِينَ. And see for yourself what was the end of the believers, the liars of the truth, who didn't accept Iman at the hands of their messengers. What happened to them? هَذَا بَيَانٌ لِلنَّاسِ وَهُدًى وَمَوْعِدَةٌ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. This Quran is a manifesto for mankind. And this is the guidance. And this is the exhortation and admonition for the God-fearing. وَلَا تَهِنُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَنْتُمُ الْعَلَوْنَ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Because there was temporary defeat, although finally Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again gave the Muslims the victory. The army had to retire, had to go back. The army of the Quraysh, Abu Sufyan, had to take back his army. But you know, temporarily there was defeat. And there were wounds inflicted. So many were injured. So actually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning, because due to that there was, the morale had gone down. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَهِنُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا. Don't get disheartened. And don't be grieved. وَأَنْتُمُ الْعَلَوْنَ. We make a solemn promise with you. You will be the supreme on earth. You will be above others. You will be supreme. إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Only if you remain mu'min. If you have real faith. If you have the real conviction. Not the verbal attestation only. The verbal attestation we have. And we are more than a billion. We have no say in the international affairs, nothing. We carry no weight, more than a billion, because we have only verbal attestation. We say that we believe in Allah. We say with our tongue, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Where is the conviction? Look to our character, our attitudes, our pursuits, our values. After what we are running, that will tell us what is the real faith, what is the real belief, what are our real goals in life. What is our value structure? So this ayah is very important. Because this proves for sure that majority of the Muslims of this time are not mu'mins. Either you have to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told a lie. Ma'az Allah. وَلَا تَهِنُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَنْتُمُ الْعَلَوْنَ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. You will be supreme. You will be above all if you are mu'min. إِن يَمْسَتْكُمْ قَرْهٌ فَقَدْ مَسَّ الْقَوْمَ قَرْهٌ مِسْلُهُ. If a wound has been inflicted upon you, O Muslims, 70 of you have been martyred to the whole community, as if just as a wound to an individual, this was a big wound to the community, to the Ummah, 70. And one of them was Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala. The other one was Hazrat Musab bin Umair radiallahu ta'ala, who was the emissary of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was sent from Makkah to teach the people of Medina Quran. And he was also martyred. إِن يَمْسَسْكُمْ قَرْهٌ فَقَدْ مَسَّ الْقَوْمَ قَرْهٌ مِسْلُهُ. If you have been inflicted with a wound, your enemies, the other people, they had also got the infliction of a wound. تِلْكَ الْأَيَّامُ نُدَاوِلُهَا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. And these days, we keep on rotating them between the people. Ups and downs, downs and ups. No nation can have the same condition throughout. Ups and downs come and go. In the history, in the life of a nation and a community. تِلْكَ الْأَيَّامُ نُدَاوِلُهَا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ وَلَيَعْلَمَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. So that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He sees who is real mu'min. If there is no adversity, if there are no testing, if there are no tribulations, how will it be proved who is a real Muslim? In conditions of ease and comfort, everybody can claim, everybody can have tall claims of Iman and Islam. It is actually on some testing, on some trial, that it can be proved who is the real mu'min. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to make it manifest. Who is the real mu'min? وَيَتَّخِذَ مِنْكُمْ شُهَدَىٰ. And He wanted to get from you some witnesses, some martyrs, so that they become the witnesses. وَاللَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الظَّالِمِينَ. It is not that Allah loves these zalimeen, these kuffar. Allah doesn't like these non-believers. But actually, if He allowed this infliction of this wound to you as an ummah, this has also some wisdom behind it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could compensate for the mistake which was committed by 35. He can condone the mistake. And this infliction, this wound, would not have come to you. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed it. Why? So that, number one, He wanted to see that it should become manifest Who is a real mu'min? Who are those who are steadfast, who can show perseverance? And number two, he wanted to have some witnesses from amongst you. Allah doesn't like these kuffar, these mushrikeen. وَلَيُمَحْرِصَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَيَمْحَقَ الْقَافِرِينَ. And that Allah may purge those who believe and may blot out the disbelievers. He wanted to liquidate the disbelievers. أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَنْ تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةِ. This ayah is very noteworthy. This is ayah number 142 of Surah Aalay-Imran. And there was ayah number 214 of Surah Al-Baqarah, starting with the same words. أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَنْ تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةِ وَلَمَّا يَعْتِكُمْ مَسَلُ الَّذِينَ خَلَوْا مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ مَسَّتْهُمُ الْبَعْسَاءُ وَالضَّرَّاءُ وَزُلْزِلُوا حَتَّى يَقُولَ الرَّسُولُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ مَتَى نَصْرُ اللَّهِ أَلَا إِنَّ نَصْرَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ. Did you think you will enter paradise? Although up till now, those tests and trials have not come to you, which came to the people who were before you. The same ayah here, a smaller ayah, but the meanings are the same. أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَنْ تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةِ. Oh Muslims, did you think you will get entry into the gardens of paradise? وَلَمَّا يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا مِنْكُمْ. And up till now, Allah Ta'ala has not seen who amongst you are the real people who make jihad. وَيَعْلَمَ السَّابِرِينَ. And Allah wants to see who are the people who have patience, who show perseverance, who are ready to take all the risks. This is to be seen until now. لَقَدْ كُنْتُمْ تَمَنَّوْنَ الْمَوْتَ مِنْ قَبْلِ. You had been longing for death. This is a reference to the people who said, we want martyrdom, we want shahada, we want to go in the field and have an open combat. Why should we, like cowards, we should sit within the wall, defend the city from within? Why not go? Because our goal is to have shahada. We want martyrdom. So actually this ayah is referring to it. It's easy to say with mouth and your tongue that you want to be martyred. But when death comes really, then it is a different matter. وَلَقَدْ كُنْتُمْ تَمَنَّوْنَ الْمَوْتَ مِنْ قَبْلِ. You had been longing for death, death of martyrdom. مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ تَلْقَوْهُ. Before you had met it. فَقَدْ رَأَيْتُمُوهُ وَأَنْتُمْ تَنْظُرُونَ. But now you have seen it with your own eyes. So death is something very bitter. It's not something very pleasant. None should long for death. We should always pray, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, save us from the trials. We are not equal to your trial. وَلَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْنَا إِسْرًا كَمَا حَمَلْتَهُ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِنَا. رَبَّنَا وَلَا تُحَمِّلْنَا مَا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا بِهِ. The prayer which we studied last night, which ends the Surah Al-Baqarah. لَقَدْ كُنْتُمْ تَمَنَّوْنَ الْمَوْتَ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ تَلْقَوْهُ فَقَدْ رَأَيْتُمُوهُ وَأَنْتُمْ تَنْظُرُونَ. وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ. The Prophet was wounded and for some time he became unconscious also. The rumor got spread that Muhammad has died. And there was a negative effect on some of the Sahaba of this rumor. If Muhammad has died, for whom should we continue the fight? It's no use. For whom? He's dead. Even this happened to Hazrat Umar رضي الله تعالى. He threw away his sword, he was sitting. But then some Sahaba said to him, if he has died for this mission, why shouldn't we die for this mission? And then again he got his sword. And then again he joined the hosts and started fighting. But this was a temporary effect on Hazrat Umar even رضي الله تعالى. So now there is a comment on this. وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ. Muhammad is nothing else but a Rasul. He is a messenger of Allah. قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ. And before him so many messengers of Allah have passed. There was Nuh, there was Hud, there was Saleh, there was Lut, there was Shu'aib, there was Ibrahim, there was Musa, there was Isa. So many prophets and messengers of Allah have passed. وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ لِلَّهِ رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَقْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِمْ مَاتَوْ قُتِلَ. So if he dies or if he is killed, he is slain, he is martyred, and قَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ, will you return back on your heels? Will you leave Islam? Will you leave Imam? Will you give up all these things and go back on your heels? وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقِبَيْهِ. Whosoever goes back on his heels, فَلَا يَضُرُّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا. He will not be harming Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He cannot give any harm to Allah. وَسَيَجْزِ اللَّهُ الشَّاكْرِينَ. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give the requisite reward to those who are really grateful. Who are grateful that He gave them Islam. He gave them Iman. He gave them Quran. And they should remain steadfast to Islam. And they should sacrifice. Keep ready to sacrifice everything for the cause of Allah. وَمَا كَانَ لِنَفْسٍ أَن تَمُوتَ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. It is not possible for any soul to die without the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody can die. كِتَابًا مُؤَجَّلًا. And this has been recorded, pre-recorded, fixed period. Everybody has a fixed life and it is pre-recorded. كِتَابًا مُؤَجَّلًا. وَمَا يُرِدْ ثَوَابَ الدُّنْيَا نُوتِهِ مِنْهَا. Whosoever wants to have the reward of dunya, please don't get offended. All of us are included in this category. Our all struggle, our all work that is aimed at getting some comfort, some luxuries of this world. We are after this world and its good things, so to say. Its luxuries, its comforts, its amenities, its name, its position, everything. مَنْ يُرِدْ ثَوَابَ الدُّنْيَا. Sawab of what? Sawab of your deeds, of your actions, of your struggle, of your hard work. The reward of your hard work. مَنْ يُرِدْ ثَوَابَ الدُّنْيَا نُوتِهِ مِنْهَا. Whosoever has decided that he intends to have all the reward of his work here in this world, we shall give here. وَمَنْ يُرِدْ ثَوَابَ الْآخِرَةِ نُوتِهِ مِنْهَا. Whosoever has fixed his goal to be akhirah. And he wanted the sawab, he wants the sawab of akhirah, the reward of akhirah. We shall give him from that. وَسَنَجْزِي الشَّاكِرِينَ. And we shall give the proper reward to those who are really grateful. وَكَيِّمْ مِنْ نَبِيٍ قَاتَلَ مَعَهُ رِبِّيُّنَا كَسِيرٌ. And so many anbiya and so many prophets have passed, with whom fought so many godly people. Just as the battle between Talut and Jalut. There were mu'mins, there were believers who were fighting the enemies. وَكَيِّمْ مِنْ نَبِيٍ قَاتَلَ مَعَهُ رِبِّيُّنَا كَسِيرٌ. So many prophets have passed, with whom people who believed in Allah, who were Rabbiyun, who were the people of God, they went to war with them, along with them. فَمَا وَهَنُوا لِمَا أَصَابَهُمْ. They were neither disheartened on what happened to them, what harms came to them. فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. In the way of Allah. وَمَا ضَعُفُوا. Nor they were weakened. وَمَا اسْتَكَانُوا. Nor they submitted, they surrendered. وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الصَّابِرِينَ. Allah loves such patient people, such persevering people. وَمَا كَانَ قَوْلَهُمْ إِلَّا أَنْ قَالُوا رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا. The same dua as the people who were fighting along with Hazrat Talut. They had prayed. وَمَا كَانَ قَوْلَهُمْ. And their prayer was only this. إِلَّا أَنْ قَالُوا. That they said, رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا. O our Lord, forgive us for our mistakes, our sins. وَإِسْرَافَنَا فِي أَمْرِنَا. And our extravagance in our matters, in our affairs. وَسَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا. And make our feet firm. وَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. And help us against the people, those people who don't believe, who are unbelievers. فَآتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ ثَوَابَ الدُّنْيَا وَحُسْنَ ثَوَابِ الْآخِرَةِ. So Allah gave them the reward of this world also, and the best reward of akhirah, of the hereafter. وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Allah loves such good doers, people who do such good deeds. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن تُطِعُوا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يَرُدُّوكُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ فَتَنْقَلِبُوا خَاسِرِينَ. O you who believe, this ayah has also passed before in the same wordings. إِن تُطِعُوا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. If you obey those who are unbelievers, who have rejected Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his da'wah, if you obey them or if you act upon their advices, يَرُدُّوكُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ. They will take you back on your heels. فَتَنْقَلِبُوا خَاسِرِينَ. And then you will turn losers. You will be in loss. بَلِ اللَّهُ مَوْلَاكُمْ. On the other side, Allah is your protector. Allah is your sustainer. Allah is your helper. وَهُوَ خَيْرُ النَّاصِرِينَ. And He is the best of the helpers. سَنُلْقِي فِي قُلُوبِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الرُّعْبَ. Very soon, We shall cast into the hearts of these unbelievers terror and fear for you. Bima ashraku billahi ma lam yunazzil bihi sultana. Because of that they associated with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala such deities, forged deities, about whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not sent down any authority, any certificate. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not certified that such and such gods are also my partners. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not certified that I have taken such and such person as my son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not given any certificate to anything, anybody, that he is my equal, my partner. Actually, this is very important, because no book which claims to be divine, which claims to have revelation, has any basis of shirk. Fatu bi kitabiko, bring forth your book. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Quran challenges the mushrikeen of Makkah. If you have something written, any book, any scripture, from any of your gods, if you claim that it is from Allah, which has come after revelation, well, bring and show us. Where is it written that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken such and such people or such and such persons as partners with him and associates with him? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not given the authority or certificate to anything that he is his partner. Because this is the biggest crime, therefore the terror and the wrath and the fear of you, O Muslims, will be cast into their hearts. And now their abode is fire. And that is a very bad resting place for the evildoers. وَلَقَدْ صَدَقَكُمُ اللَّهُ وَعْدَهُ. Now this is the most important comment. That you Muslims, you cannot complain to us for this affliction that you got, for this wound that was inflicted on your body. It is your own doing. It is due to your own mistake. You can't blame us. You can't complain to us. We had given you the victory as we had promised. وَلَقَدْ صَدَقَكُمُ اللَّهُ وَعْدَهُ. Allah had fulfilled with you His promise. إِذْ تَحُسُّونَهُمْ بِإِذْنِهِ. When you were exterminating them with His command, with His help, with His command, you were killing them. You had routed them. They were running. They were on their heels. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had fulfilled His promise. وَلَقَدْ صَدَقَكُمُ اللَّهُ وَعَدَهُ إِذْ تَحُسُّونَهُمْ بِإِذْنِهِ حَتَّى إِذَا فَشِلْتُمْ. But when you loosened the discipline, you got loosened, hatta idha fashiltum. Now this looseness, what I understand is the looseness of discipline, of sab'ata'ah. Because the commander at that place, who was heading those 50 archers, he never permitted anybody to go and leave that place. So they broke the discipline. Fashil means weakness. You showed the weakness. But not weakness individually, weakness as a group. Because the group is only powerful when it is disciplined, when it is cohesive, when it is bunyanum barsus, then it is powerful. And when the discipline is loose, then it becomes very weak. Hatta idha fashiltum wa tanaza'tum fil amr. And you disputed about the matter. Your commander was saying not to leave, and you left. And you said that the Prophet had said, that if all of us are killed, and you see the birds are eating our flesh, even then you don't leave this place. But now the situation is contrary. There is victory for the Muslims. There's no need of staying here. So they left that place. So that was the dispute. Although because the commander was not permitting, they shouldn't have left that place. It was duty for them to obey. As the Prophet says, Man ata'ani faqad ata'a Allah. وَمَنْ عَصَانِي فَقَدْ عَصَى اللَّهِ وَمَنْ أَتَعَى أَمِيرِي فَقَدْ أَتَعَانِي وَمَنْ عَصَى أَمِيرِي فَقَدْ عَصَانِي. Whosoever obeys me, he obeys Allah. Whosoever disobeys me, he disobeys Allah. Whosoever obeys an Amir appointed by me, he obeys me. And whosoever disobeys an Amir who has been appointed by me, actually he is disobeying me. So it amounted to a disobedience of the Prophet. Although actually, for them, it was not disobedience of the Prophet, but it was the disobedience to the commander, according to the saying of the Prophet, amounts to the disobedience to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hatta idha fashiltum wa tanazatum fil amr wa asaytum min baadi ma araakum ma tuhibbun. And you disobeyed After Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed you what you like and what you love, most of the mufassireen, they say that it means the booty, the maal-e-ghanimat, the anfal, the spoils of the war. Then they ran from their position to collect the booty, to collect the spoils. I disagree here. Because after the battle of Badr, the law about anfal was given. Whether somebody had collected something or not, it was irrelevant now. All the booty, all the spoils, all the anfal were to be collected and then distributed equally. The double share was to go to the riders who have some horse or camel also with them. They used to feed them. And single share for the people, for the footman, whosoever is a soldier, foot soldier. So actually there was no need of their leaving that place to collect the spoils. It was absolutely irrelevant. So what they loved was victory. And I have the example in Surah As-Saff. وَأُخْرَى تُحِبُّونَهَا نَصْرٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَفَتْحٌ قَرِيمٌ. Actually, after seeing this victory, they loosened. And this resulted in the loosening of their discipline, and this resulting in that they disputed with their Amir, and that became the cause for the big defeat. Temporary, although it was, but it was a big defeat, no doubt. That was the result of all this. But this was all your own doing. It is not from Allah. Only Allah didn't obstruct it. Allah let it happen. Allah gave the permission, let it happen. This is also based on a wisdom, so that you have a lesson for future, so that you can mend your ways for the time to come. Otherwise, if the punishment didn't come, you could be very loose in your behavior afterwards also. So it was to teach you a lesson that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't condone your mistake, but anyhow what happened was due to your mistake. It's very important and very profound ayah. وَلَقَدْ صَدَقَكُمُ اللَّهُ وَعَدَهُ إِسْتَهُسُّونَهُ بِإِذْنِهِ حَتَّى إِذَا فَشِلْتُمْ وَتَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ وَعَسَيْتُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا أَرَاكُمْ مَا تُحِبُّونَ مِنْكُمْ مَنْ يُرِيدُ الدُّنْيَا. Amongst you are those who intend to have this world. Fatah is also for this world. وَمِنْكُمْ مَنْ يُرِيدُ الْآخِرَةِ. And there are among those who really want to have Akhirah. ثُمَّ صَرَفَكُمْ عَنْهُمْ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned your faces from them. When the Quraysh were running, the Muslims were chasing them. But now, when there was the charge from behind of the cavalry of the Quraysh, now the faces of the Muslims were turned back. So now the tables were turned, and now the Quraysh were chasing them. So this was, ثُمَّ صَرَفَكُمْ عَنْهُمْ لَيَبْتَلِيَكُمْ. So as to put you into a test. It was a testing for you. وَلَقَدْ عَفَا عَنْكُمْ. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven you. Your mistake has been condoned. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not take you to task for this mistake now. Now, we have pardoned you, we have forgiven you. وَاللَّهُ ذُو فَضْلٍ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And Allah is very bountiful for the mu'mineen, for the believers. إِذْ تُسْعِدُونَ وَلَا تَلْغُونَ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ مِّنْكُمْ. When you were ascending, going up the mountain, and you were not paying any heed to anybody, وَالرَّسُولُ يَدْعُوكُمْ فِي أُخْرَاكُمْ. And in your rear, the messenger was calling you. What happened? You know, there was panic. And in that panic, most of the Muslims ran towards the Uhud mountain so that they can save themselves by going up the mountain. Now they are running towards the mountain, climbing the mountain. The Prophet is in the rear. He's calling them. إِلَيَّ يَا عِبَادَ اللَّهِ. Where are you going? Come towards me. O bondsmen of Allah, O servants of Allah, come towards me. إِلَيَّ يَا عِبَادَ اللَّهِ. إِسْتُسْعِدُونَ وَلَا تَلْبُونَ. But in such an emergency, nobody has any idea of the other. Everybody thinks about himself, his safety. إِسْتُسْعِدُونَ. You were climbing the mountain. وَلَا تَلْبُونَ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ. And you were not turning back to take care of anybody else. وَالرَّسُولُ يَدْعُوكُمْ فِي أُخْرَاكُمْ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was calling you from your rear. فَأَصَابَكُمْ غَمَّمْ بِغَمِّنْ. Now, there was grief after grief for you. The grief of the defeat, the grief of the wounding of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the grief of the rumor that the Prophet had been killed. So grief over grief, grief after grief. لِكَيْلَا تَحْزَنُوا عَلَىٰ مَا فَاتَكُمْ. So that you become seasoned, and in the future, you don't grieve at whatever befalls you, وَلَا مَا أَصَابَكُمْ Whatever you miss and whatever befalls you. وَاللَّهُ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ And whatever you are doing, Allah is aware of it. ثُمَّ أَنْزَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ الْغَمِّ أَمَنَةً نُعَاسًا And then afterwards, after this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down on you a slumber, a security and peace and tranquility. It so happened that in the war, it was very unusual. But some of the sahaba say, we felt like sleeping. You know, sleep comes only when there is contentment in the heart. When there is conflicts within you, you can't sleep. So actually, this was a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah is mentioning it as such. ثُمَّ أَنْزَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ الْغَمِّ أَمَنَةً نُعَاسًا يَخْشَى طَائِفَةً مِنْكُمْ A party among you was feeling sleepy. وَطَائِفَةٌ قَدْ أَهَمَّتْهُمْ أَنْفُسُهُمْ There was other group also who were very thoughtful about themselves. What will happen to us? Who were trying to save their souls. يَظُنُّونَ بِاللَّهِ غَيْرَ الْحَقِّ ظَنَّ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ And they were thinking about Allah, the thoughts of jahiliyyah. Which were not based on reality. What has happened? Were we wrong? Is Muhammad not the messenger of Allah? What has happened? If he was really messenger of Allah, how could this happen to him? How could this happen to us? Shaitan? Alladhi yuwaswisu fi sudurin nas. He puts so many ideas and these things come without the intention of a person. These ideas cross your minds without intending it. You have no control over this. يَظُنُّونَ بِاللَّهِ غَيْرَ الْحَقِّ ذَنَّ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ They were unjustly thinking about the thought of ignorance. يَقُولُونَ هَلْ لَنَا مِنَ الْأَمْرِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ Now this is the saying of some of the munafiqeen. They said, is there anything for us regarding the authority? Do we have some part in authority? What did they mean? Abdullah ibn Ubay said that we should defend the city from within the walls of the city. We are not in a position to go and confront the enemy in the open field. Now they thought that had this opinion been accepted, then we would not have suffered this disaster. هَلَّنَا مِنَ الْأَمْرِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ Now we should have authority, our opinions should be respected, decisions should be made according to the opinion of the people, because the decision was made exclusively by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He saw that some of the mu'mineen, some of the people, especially the youth, and as I told you, especially those who couldn't go to Badr. Now they wanted to have a chance to fight for the cause of Allah. So the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he kept their sentiments. He kept before him the sentiments of such mu'mineen and sadiqeen, and he decided in the favor that we will go out and have the confrontation in the open field. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given them the victory. This was not due to a mistake. In this decision, this was due to the mistake of those 35 Sahaba who disobeyed their commander. But now there was an occasion for the munafiqeen to say, "Hallana min al-amri min shay." Do we have any part in authority in decision of the matters? Qul inna al-amra kullahu billah. Tell them, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, authority is totally with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody has any authority. Now what does it mean? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala holds the authority. And now his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is his representative. He had the exclusive authority to decide. And you, if you have real belief, if you really believe in him, you must accept him and accept his command, and you must obey him from the depths of your hearts. يُخْفُونَ فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ مَا لَا يَبْدُونَ لَكْ O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they are hiding in their hearts what they are not disclosing to you. They are saying something else. They mean something else. What they mean? يقولون Actually what they are saying. That is, لَوْ كَانَ لَنَا مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٌ مَا قُتِلْنَا هَاهُنَا If we had some say in the affairs, if our opinion was respected, if the decision was made according to our advice, we would not have been killed here. قُلْ لَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُيُوتِكُمْ Tell them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even if you were in your homes and houses, لَبَرَضَ الَّذِينَ كُتِبَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقَتْلِ On whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written already that he will be killed. He would have anyhow come to this place where he was to be killed. لَبَرَضَ الَّذِينَ كُتِبَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقَتْلُ إِلَى مَضَاجِعِهِمْ Wherever they have been killed today, they would have come here anyhow, even they were in their houses and homes. because the decision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that cannot be obstructed by anybody, by any policy, by any decision, by any means, by any methods, that has to be carried out. لَبَرَزَ الَّذِينَ كُتِبَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقَتْلُ إِلَىٰ مَضَادِعِهِمْ وَلِيَبْتَلِيَ اللَّهُ مَا فِي صُدُورِكُمْ. And all this happened only, Allah wants to test what is in your hearts, what is in your chests. وَلَيُمَحْحِسَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. And He wants to purge whatever is in your hearts. Because if with Iman there is some pollution of nifaq also, it must be cleansed, it must be cleared. If Iman and there is some weakness also, these weaknesses should be cleansed and cleared. So the purging of your hearts was the main issue. وَلَيُمَحْحِسَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِذَاتِ الصُّدُورِ. And Allah knows what is there in the chests of the people, in the hearts of the people. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَوَلَّوْا مِنْكُمْ يَوْمَ الْتَقَى الْجَمْعَانِ. Verily those who left the field and who showed their backs to the fighting on that day in which two armies confronted each other, إِنَّمَا اسْتَغَلَّهُمُ الشَّيْطَانِ. Actually it was Shaitan who made them slip, but he could make them slip بِبَعْضِ مَا كَسَبُوا. Due to some of their actions, they had done some sins, they had committed some mistakes, they had committed some weaknesses, and due to those weaknesses, Shaitan could hold them, and Shaitan could have some effect on them, and could have some influence on them. Istadallahumu Shaitan. Using that influence, he made them slip. وَلَقَدْ عَفَى اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ. But about such people also, Allah declares here, Allah has already pardoned them. Allah has accepted their tawbah. They will not be questioned about it now. Case is closed. This case of Ghazwatul Uhud, that is closed. Whosoever committed some weakness, committed some mistake, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned it only so that you can rectify them. You can purify your ranks. You can rectify your weaknesses and mistakes. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not punish them for these weaknesses and mistakes. وَلَقَدْ عَفَى اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ. Allah has pardoned them. Please note here that among those people who left the battlefield was also Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And people who are enemies of Sahaba, who don't like Sahaba anyhow, they use this thing as a propaganda against Hazrat Uthman up till now, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. But the reply given by one of the Sahaba in those days, when some of the people who rose in revolt against Hazrat Uthman during the caliphate of Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when they enumerated this charge also against him, that he had fled the field on the day of Uhud, so he is not trustworthy and he is not capable of having this high office of Khilafah. The answer given was, Allah had pardoned him. Allah had declared the pardoning to all those people. He was not alone. There were many, because there was panic. The situation was so extraordinary. What happened was so instantaneous, so to say, what we call involuntarily. Some of the people left the field. There were chaos. So Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu was also one of them. But here Allah declares, وَلَقَدْ عَفَى اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ. Allah has already pardoned them and forgiven them. إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورُ الْحَلِيمُ. Verily and definitely and surely Allah is Ghafoor, He is merciful and He is forbearing. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Quranil Azeem wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikril hakeem.